We have different companies, and it's clear from the companies that what they build at the moment are sourcing teams. So they have teams of workers in which one is a geomorphologist, one is a GIS specialist, one is a sequence stratigraphy specialist, and one is a geochemist, for instance. So that's a team of four. But of course, they look for researchers who have the biggest background possible so that they can communicate with each other. You know, if your specialty is clastic sedimentology, but you know about these geomorphological processes and terms, you will be better in a better situation, in a better position to interact with a geomorphologist or a numerical modeler, for instance. Okay, so that's my expectation for this course. Okay, after the source, I wanted to speak about the transfer system. So what is the transfer system is in between the source and the basin. And so here I have represented a section of the transfer system. So it's a block, it's like a piece of the cake. You see the section and you see the river and the floodplain. So this is meant to represent a channel, but it could be a belt of channels. So it's a fluvial system if you want, and it's just a segment, okay? But in my mind, and these are unfinished figures, but in my mind, I'm speaking here about at least 10 kilometers of length, okay? And several kilometers to several tens of kilometers of width. This could be hundreds, you know, length and width, okay? So we are speaking at the scale of a basin. And here, this is the floodplain. So it's flat, or it has basically the same slope as the river. There is a slope, but it's very small, like all fluvial systems. And this label here is to show kind of a vegetation, you know, on the floodplain, you have some sort of vegetation, but it's basically flat and dry when the system is not flooded. And so here you have an input and an output. So there is sediment coming in and sediment going out. That's why it's a transfer system. It transfers sediment. But as you can see, there is also subsidence. And because of subsidence, the output is a little bit smaller than the input. And I should have written this somewhere. Okay. And what is stored is basically subsidence times the transfer area. You know, if you basically in this system, if the system is at equilibrium, it's a concept we haven't really defined yet, but if a system is in balance, the topography doesn't change. Okay. So sedimentation equals subsidence. If there is 1 millimeter of subsidence and 1 millimeter of sedimentation, the elevation of my system does not change. And so the amount of sediment stored, the stock of sediment in this cake, is equal to the drainage area, the transfer area multiplied by subsidence. Okay, this has unit of L square, and this has unit of L times T exponent minus one, L divided by T. Okay, so the transfer system is simply this. It's a system which receives sediment, transfers some of it, but there is storage in between, okay? And here you have a section where you see channels, former channels, And in gray is the fine sediments of the floodplain. In this long strike direction, you have strata, fluvial strata. Because of storage, the transfer system is important because any signal, any change in the input function will be modified by storage. Okay? You remember yesterday when I made the analogy with somebody speaking in the microphone and you with your headphones, you receive the signal. If there is a storage of some words in between, then you don't receive all the words in your ear. It's the same here. If there is storage of sediment, maybe the output is not, the output function is not exactly equal to the input function. Okay, so let's say you have climatic variation of QS in, maybe QS out does not reflect exactly the QS in. And so if you are in the marine delta fed by this transfer system, maybe you do not see exactly what happens upstream in the input function. Okay?
Yes.
All right, just in terms still of dimension that I forget to say is that, how can I reduce this? It's impossible. In terms of dimensions, you know, you can have no transfer system. The length can be zero if you have your basin just connected to your drainage basin. So your sedimentary basin just directly connected to the source area. You can think about islands such as Taiwan, for instance. The eastern side of Taiwan, the mountain range grows and it delivers directly into the sea. The Alps is not the case. You know, the Rhone River goes into the Lake Geneva and then goes all along the Alps and ends up into the Rhone Delta. Okay, so some orogenic systems, some source areas are directly connected to the sea, but some have a transfer system in between. And so in the longest transfer system, we speak about thousands of kilometers. If you think about the Amazon River, it has its sources in the Andes, Andean mountain range, and then it goes all along into the Amazon forest, and it ends up on the eastern side of South America. So this is several thousands of kilometers long system, and it's also probably 1,000 kilometer wide. Okay. The whole Amazon forest is the little vegetation thing here. You have a big fluvial basin. Okay. Now my next slide is to speak not about dimensions of length, but dimensions of time. Okay. To continue on the topic of the time scale of storage. And here I have put let's do like this. I have put three different timescales. Okay. One is less or equal to 1 million years. One is about 1 million years and more. And this is several tens of million years. Okay. So here, maybe it's not so clear, I should be more specific, but here I think about 20,000 years, 100,000 years, 400,000 years, kind of. So these are clearly climatic cycles, okay, timescales. On those timescales, so as you remarked, these are my hand drawings. I did not finish drawing all of my figures. You know, I'm currently doing this, and it's a good opportunity to show you this, for instance. I do not know if you use Illustrator, but I strongly advise you to use it. So the previous figure, for instance, I hand draw first, and then I draw above it. You know, with do you see my screen? The yeah. Drawing. So
yes.
So I think it's important that as soon as possible, you know, you have a lot of tools like the perspective tool in Illustrator. You have tons of very, very useful tools to draw your own figures. I think it's very important that you do that. So you can take an existing figure, put it in Illustrator, and draw your own figure modified on top of it. And then you just keep your own figure, or you draw yourself by hand, import it, and then draw above. Okay. So yeah, I still need to work on that. And but here what I wanted to show is this, let's start here. This line here, okay, is a river, the riverbed, a river profile. Okay, so it has a little slope, and you look at a segment of the river. Basically, it's looking from here to here, okay, but from the side. So we see only that it has a slope, okay, and it receives sediment here and it delivers sediment there. Okay. One way to do aggradation, to store sediment, is when you have an increase in base level. Okay. Base level can be the sea level, the ocean level. It can also be, you know, that it can also be subsidence. Okay, so the this is something we've done in sequence stratigraphy in the second year with Geneva student, at least, is that base level is a notion that embodies tectonics and sea level or lake level as well. Okay, so it's the niveau de base. It's a reference level, and when it rises, then the river adapts its profile, and you have aggradation. You have sedimentation. Is that clear?
Yes.
Okay. So that's a way of storage by, I wrote perturbation aval. So it's a downstream perturbation. The signal comes from downstream. Okay. Now, here the river receives sediment and water from the upstream side. So I take the same initial configuration as here, my initial river level in this little sketch, but now I don't change base level. There is no change in base level here. The only thing I change is what's coming in the system. It can be QW, Q water, so the quantity of water coming in, the quantity of sediment coming in, or the grain size, D50. You've seen D50, the concept of D50 with Stephen Watkins.
Okay? Yes.
So it's the caliber, it's the grain size, it's one measure of the grain size coming in the system. And so if you change those parameters, you can actually aggrade or you can degrade. Let's say if you increase water discharge and you do not change sediment supply, or you do not change grain size, but you increase water discharge, what happens? Do you aggrade or do you degrade? Do you think you incise your river or you sediment, you deposit?
We deposit.
So if you increase water discharge, you will incise. Imagine a river has the same quantity of sediment, is at equilibrium, is nice, If you increase water discharge only, the river will tend to incise because the flow becomes more powerful.
Okay.
So if the river has the same amount of sediment to transfer, then it will be more powerful and it will incise. So this is what you can see here. When you have terraces in a river, and you see that there are terraces left behind here, it's because the river is incising into it. And that's when there is more water. If, however, you increase, let's say you increase suddenly, your river is transporting at equilibrium, your river is transporting gravels of 1-2 centimeter size, and suddenly there is many landslides in the mountain, and suddenly the sediment that come into your river system are all 10 centimeter of diameter. So big boulders, big cobbles, big pebbles. If this happens and the water discharge did not change, then the river will not be able, with its current gradient, with its current slope, the river will not be able to transport such large grain size, and therefore it will aggrade. Okay, the coarse grains will be deposited because they cannot be transported. And this deposition will make the profile rise until you reach a certain profile, steeper, at which the river will now be able to transport the sediment. Because of course, with a steeper profile, the water runs faster and it's able, with faster velocity, with higher velocity, the river is now able to transport bigger grains. So this is a perturbation amont, so it's an upstream perturbation. It comes from upstream, okay? And this is the terraces that that's a drawing where we see a river. It's supposed to be a 3D drawing, kind of something like that, where you see a river and you see a terrace here, okay? There's a flat part. I mean, it's not flat exactly, but it has a slope which is steeper. So it's this one, and this is the profile we see now. So there was aggradation, and now maybe the water discharge increased and there's been degradation to here. So that's also what you see here. You have aggradation, and then, so that's the steeper profile in this drawing by Stefanie Tofelde. I didn't put the reference, and I should do it exactly now before. Because this is important. Sorry, but since I do videos and these videos maybe will be somewhere, I absolutely need to be strict with where the things come from. And I'm not always as strict as I should. Stofelde. Stefanie. Sorry, a small break. Where is this paper by Stefanie? It's here. I will put the reference like that. You can access the paper. So Stefanie is she graduated last year, I think, in Potsdam, and she did a PhD on exactly what controls aggradation, degradation, terrace formation, and the influence of grain size, sediment supply, water discharge, because of course this flight here, this succession of terraces, then tells us something about changing climate upstream in the source area. Okay, so the young terrace is the highest, the old terrace is the lowest. So we have a succession of aggradation event and then degradation. Is that okay?
Yes.
Yes.
Cool. The important message here is that if you have terraces, not all the sediment coming from upstream has been transferred downstream. Okay, so the sediment coming into, for instance, the Rhone Delta over the last million years, because we know there is terraces in the Alps, there is terraces everywhere in the Alps, it means that the climate signals that have affected the Alpine region, they have not been fully transmitted in terms of sediment flux, they have not been fully transmitted to the Rhone Delta. There have been a part of it has been stored into alluvial terraces in Alpine valleys. Okay, not all the sediment reaches instantly from the source to the sink at this intermediate timescales of climate change. Okay, and this storage means that some of the signal coming from upstream is buffered. Okay, there is a buffer effect. I should go back here. Okay, buffer, BUFFER. Okay, the buffer effect, c'est tampon, un effet tampon en français. Okay, so it means that the output signal is lower, of smaller amplitude, and maybe it's also modified in terms of time, period, duration, arrival. So there is this buffer. Okay, how can I change this now? Pointer option, pent, arrow, hidden. Oh, this is nice. Okay, now there is another effect is that, so here it's also not super clear in those drawings, they are really temporary, but here I have a thrust fault. And this is the side of a mountain, a little bit like this, okay? But we just see the lower part. And there is a drainage area feeding a fallen basin, okay? We have lower plate going down and we have a fallen basin here. But this fallen basin is full. And so sediment is stored here and there is subsidence, but the river continues. Okay, and goes to the sea. In this case, we have a long transfer system here, and part of the sediment is stored here, but it's on a longer term. It's not this kind of time scale of aggradation, incision of terraces. It's on a longer time scale. Okay, we have also this at the scale of continental craton, continental systems, where we can have a sag basin, a pond is not the good way, but the good term. But you know, these large cratonic basins, like the Paris Basin, for instance, they are big depression in the middle, in the center of continents. They can be due to different processes, and we'll see that later. But we can also have a rift, okay. And we also have passive margin. When you reach a passive margin, like the west coast of France or the west coast of Africa or the east coast of South America, the east coast of North America, you know, your river, they come in and then they reach the sea. But as they come in here, there is subsidence due to the cooling of the margin. It's very small amount of subsidence, but still there is some storage. Look at the Mississippi River, for instance. You know, it's delivering sediment to the Mississippi Delta, but there is storage before that. And so all of these processes, basin scale, continental scale, subsidence, traps sediment in basins before the transfer system reach its ultimate sink in the sea, okay? So in a way, it just says that there is intermediate things. Okay, at geology, what this is what I call geological timescales. Okay, we are at the million year and more timescale, and that's geological timescale. So when you have a millimeter of subsidence over a million year, it's 1 kilometer. So you store a lot of sediment. Here we are not even speaking about subsidence too much. We're speaking about just base level changes, whether it's upstream driven or downstream driven. Okay, so this is another type of storage, and you see that here, for instance, a cross section through a fallen basin. That's a drawing from Laurie Barrier in IPGP Paris. And so here you would have alluvial fans, marine system, even maybe. And this is already storage in a fallen basin. Okay, now we go at a bigger time scale. And here the drawing is really even worse. But what you see is a cross section here on that side. And in this side, it's supposed to be perspective. You see the flank of an anticline here and the flank of another anticline here. And there is a valley cutting through it with a river going through it and ending here. And in between, you have thrust with piggyback basins. And basically what I wanted to sketch here is the fact that on longer time scales, some of these basins, like this one, become themselves sources of sediment. Okay? At some point, your basin becomes involved into the deformation zone, and it becomes itself a source. So there is recycling, okay? There is cannibalism. And that's on the time scale of the life cycle of basins, la durée de vie des bassins. So this is several million years, several tens of million years sometimes. So I want to show you my video, if it works. Let me see. Arrow. Click this and I will show it to you here. Just a small video. Just a small video of an erosional fold and thrust belt. There are many videos like this, and we can see, I don't know which one is best actually, maybe this one is better. But I really like those videos because they really show, you know, you have you have a plate going down. This, I believe, is Geoscience Montpellier. Maybe Geoscience Rennes. I should know. This is the lower plate. It's the plate going below. And here you have an accretionary wedge, okay, with a backstop here that stops sediment from moving. And you have several layers to follow the deformation. The layers, they show you deformation. And in those experiments, you see you have a back thrust here, and you have thrusts, faults, and folding, okay? And you see all of this going down, trying to go down and under thrusting this mass of sediment here, of rocks. And also the people doing the experiments here, Perrin and colleagues, they erode what's going up here and they deposit it there or there, okay? So there is, and it's really analog to what happens in a mountain range when you have thrusting, folding, erosion, and sedimentation, local sedimentation in basins. So let's continue and maybe watch a couple more. But as you see, it's very impressive. You grow faults and you propagate them sometimes far away. I'm going to show you this one, very nice, coming up. You see they pile up and they contract. You see this one? This could be, it's taking things far, but this could be the Jura, for instance, okay? and you will have the Alps, and you see how the rocks have been going down and they are brought up. Can you imagine how these red rocks went down and are now really high up in the mountain? If you continue erosion, you're going to see them. Look at the orange layer. Some of it is here, some of it is here, some of it is here. Look at the black layers. Some of it is there. Most of it has been eroded here. Look at the blue as well. Okay. And so here is the Jura, for instance. And look at this poof. Have you seen this one growing in the middle? This could be the Salève just growing in the middle afterwards. I don't know. The Salève could also be this one, and then the Jura is further away. But you see, there are some thrusts developing, we say, in sequence when they develop outwards, and some thrusts and faults develop out of sequence when they develop in the middle, in the mountain, after the most external ones have developed. And I really like to see that you have sedimentation here and erosion there, okay? And these sediment, they are also eroded and they also feed the basin in the front. Oops. Second, let's continue. Voilà, you see more thrust developing, so it's quite a beautiful experiment. We can watch this one, it even has music. But you see it very slowly. Maybe I stop the music. You see things developing slowly here. Oh, maybe it's too slow. Okay. Anyway, I quit this and I come back to... How can I quit that? All right. I move this out. And I come back to my PowerPoint presentation. I just want to show you one more thing on that aspect. It's something I just found this morning. It should be here in my downloads. Let me show you that. This is window zoom. This is a PDF by Ole Martinsen, who at that time was a chief geologist for Statoil, now Equinor. And it's a an abstract from the NORAL presentation given at the conference in 2016. And it's a source to sink approach to drainage and sediment flux in thrust and fallen systems. And I can share this with you, but there is the PDF of his presentation. And I really like those images fallen thrust belt. And you see some these are diagrams from a paper that I cited before by Tor Somme. And I bring you here. These are also things that I cited before by the Allen group. But here you see how faults, you see that the strata, they dip. I don't know exactly where the north is, but let's imagine that at least they dip to the right, the strata. And they've been eroded, and you see you have rivers crossing them. I think the river is actually going from here to there. And you have local drainage systems that take sediment out, bring them here, and then this is transferred them this way. So basically, you have periods of deposition and incision upstream of topography, incision through uplift, and local drainage that are oriented in different directions. And you also have local storage, you have local alluvial fans here, possibly. Okay, and this is, these are thrust, you know, this is very analogous to the video we have just seen. I hope you see the correspondence. And here he comes to sediment storage in thrust belts. You have a cross section by Pete De Sils, and you see thrust and faults, and you have synclines and sedimentation, you know, in those synclines. And so then, or even large scale sedimentation there, but you see a succession of storage and conformities, and then erosion and recycling and cannibalism. Okay. And the question here, do these sediments reach the sink, is one of the questions. So this really echoes, I think, and allows me to make the link with what I'm speaking about here, is that on long time scale, the on the lifetime of basins, those transfer systems, they also become sinks for the next basins. And that's very important for you. If you're looking at sediments in the sink, you would like to know if those sediments have already been deposited once or maybe twice, because when they are deposited, they go through transformation. Okay, for instance, their thermochronometric record, their thermochronometric memory may be reset. Okay, their mineralogy may be changed. You can, with subsidence in basins here, with subsidence going on and temperature increasing, maybe you change the mineralogy. Maybe you transform some feldspaths into plagioclase. There is the albitization phenomena, for instance. And so you can have a lot of processes going on in those basins. And so when you cannibalize, the sediment going here is reflecting what has happened here. It's a convolution of what has happened in the source area and here into the storage system. Is that okay?
Yes.
Okay, so thank you for that. I will now, I think, make a break. So we can have a 10 minutes, 15 minutes break maximum, and I will open again at 11:15, if that's okay for you.
Okay.